Thank you very much for all the questions. Here are my answers. I hope you will enjoy it. When I start writing music, I always try to find what in the moment. It can be different kind of approaches. I sometimes just play around and then I find the melody, or I do something with sound design which drags me into a motivation to follow this kind of path, or I have a name in my mind about something that gives like a small backstory which I think I have to follow it, and then I try to create like a soundtrack to it. So or I make a beat and start building on the beat the sequences. So these are different kind of approach that start making music. So, and these different approaches are also combining in a process of making a track. So when I start doing it on a beat, then I get an idea for a backstory, which I write the soundtrack for it. Then in this process, I find another melody, which leads to a new harmony or to a vocal. Then I start writing maybe lyrics about the backstory that came before my mind, which are layered some strings for it. So it goes back and forth, and different approaches. The best tool to get this kind of electro feeling and electro sound, you're choosing a Roland TR-808, samples or plugin, or I don't know where you get the sound from. I mean, it's not so hard to get them. So you can do it with a computer, or you can do it with hardware, whatever fits your best need. So make a beat with an 808 and then some sequence and bass lines. And from there, you do your training, and after a while, you're expanding to the way that's your kind of style or whatever. That would be my advice. I don't use much arps. The sequences from my productions are mostly sequences that I have played. Mostly I start playing stuff, and then I record the stuff, and then I do the edits and edit the sequence to the point where I like it. Most of my sequences are very short, and then it's a mix of the sequence and the sound design, which brings the sequence alive. I have here the arrangement on my computer from the track Electro Don't Stop, and the sequence is originally the Nord Lead 3, and first I let it play from the wave, and then I will switch to the Nord Lead 3, so you see how the sound design evolves the sequence. And the sequence itself is nothing special. The sound design is very important to this. So this is the wave. I could make it more interesting if I would go to the wavetable. Now I I switch to the knobby 3, which has a more gritty, more... It's the same notes, it's two oscillators, and yeah, the sound, it makes it more aggressive. So this is more like, more dreamy. Of course, I could go and put a second oscillator on it, and then tune in it, and then it becomes more like a more futuristic thing. So back to the... So this is how I do it. Arpeggiators I'm using if I want to sequence something that's in tune with a harmony or with a chord and something like this, then I find this more in a better way to do some stuff that's more harmonic. But these sequences that you heard now and other that I made, I really play them on the keyboard. As a DAW, I'm using Logic 9. It's a very old system. It's on Mac OS X 10.6, and I'm using MIDI interfaces, old ones from eMagic, which turned later into Apple, and I do everything with MIDI. I don't have a system with audio clock to MIDI clock or something like this. I really do everything with MIDI, and I must say, the way I hear how things are in sync, I have no problems. I know from many people they have problems with sync, and they use different things to get the sync right, like special clocks that clock over audio and to get a better timing. But I feel I don't have timing problems, and when I do MIDI sync my sequencer, like the Zirklon, it's perfect in timing in the way I hear timing. I'm not so, let's say, I don't want stuff to be like in time on sample. That's not my thing, because anyway, I use everything with MIDI, so I always have the timings differences from the different machines. So like this machine has an other latency as the Voyager or the SH-101 or the JX-8P. So I always have to move my MIDI timings of the different MIDI tracks to get it into a certain groove. And that's what I'm doing anyways, because sometimes I want stuff to be more late or stuff to be rushing, and I have to do it anyways. But timing general, I don't have a problem with this. It's perfect for my needs. When I write music, it's like a journey. It starts with something, like could be a beat or could be a melody or could be an idea, could be a backstory, could be a sound design, and then things it's getting like a movie, like a challenge, like a adventure. Sounds and beats and arrangement and everything, it combines also with the daily life. When I'm listening to the stuff in my car, when I'm listening to the stuff at my home on headphones, so everything goes into, when I produce the music, it goes into this process. When I write lyrics, it's more like that it gets into a story or something like this. So this adds another layer to the creative process, because it resonates with the music, the voice. So I can say that writing music is, for me, is something like, yeah, like energy, like a food, like something that, yeah, my soul needs this. When I write music, I feel very fulfilled with this doing this creative process. When I design sounds, it's combination of what it plays, the sequence or the melodies, chords or whatever, also drums, grooves, and the sound design. Like mostly as it starts with a sequence or with a melody. Then I record the MIDI notes, and then I design the sound specially for that melody. So sometimes I do also make sounds without any purpose, just playing around, stuff like this. And these sounds are mostly more for, let's say, playing stuff. Playing melodies, playing chords and stuff like this. When I produce, when I'm in production and I make sounds for a sequence, these sounds, when you try to play something with these sounds, it's nearly useless, because these sounds are short or strange in the attack or something like this. You cannot play regular stuff with it. It's really the combination of the sound design and the sequence that makes this stuff so special. And when I do experimental music, it's stuff that has a slower tempo, a slower progression. So these sounds are, from the sound design, you can do more stuff with this and play around. So these stuff are more to play, because for the experimental stuff, much of the stuff I play live or overdub the stuff. So these sounds are, they have a different kind of playability. When I design sounds, or when I'm in a production, I can hear sometimes sounds, and because the way I when I do sound design, I can see the sound in a shape, and the synthesizer is like a shape drawer. I can draw then the shape when I hear the sound. I see it in my mind, and then I can draw the sound with the synthesizer, or other way around. I hear a sound and I know how it looks, so I can redraw it with a synthesizer. So this is mostly how I do it. And the great thing on synthesizers is on a certain complexity, it's not something you can imagine anymore. So to go into this kind of like FM synthesis or sync sounds or cross modulation stuff like this, I love it, because you imagination goes to a certain point, and then you do stuff that, yeah, is something you have not thought about it before, and this pushes you to another idea where you can take on and then reshape it again. So I really love sound design. I really love to work with synthesizers and dive into sound design and design sounds on the synthesizer. The the instrument or the synthesizer that I have the longest is the Roland JD-800. I bought this synthesizer in the year 1992 and I've been using it till today. This synthesizer taught me how to synthesize, how to edit sounds. Yeah, it taught me very much, very much. And till today, because of its broad capability sound with all the PCM waves in there, I still use it. It's a how you call it? Evergreen? Yeah, it's an evergreen. I explain the signal chain of my system. I have a digital mixing board called Avid SC48. It's a live mixing board with Pro Tools plugins installed on this, and all the gear is wired into the mixer, so everything is in real time. The mixer is also the sound card, so it's with FireWire connected to the computer, and I can route the stuff that's in the mixer connected to the logic and record it there, or I can also route the plugins that I'm use on the computer, like a EXS24 sampler, into the mixer. But I mix down on the mixing board. I don't mix in the computer. So the mix bus signal at the end goes into a SPL cult tube, which has a tube, and I only use it to give the digital sound from the mixing board this kind of analog sound. I can't really describe it, but when I switch the cool tube on, it makes everything sound better. So this is in the mix bus, in the main output, and that's how I record my pre-masses then. And I think I have then both of the worlds. I have the precision of the digital mixing board, and with the cool tube, it gives that warmth that in the midst. Yeah, it gives that kind of sound that you don't get from the digital mixing board itself. I use also outboard equipment for effects and stuff like this. I have also effects for guitars and stuff like this, small distortion pedals and stuff like this, which I also use to create different sounds. I also have filters from the Polymoog to sometimes narrow and edit sounds from desynthesizers. So it's like a big modular system. I can connect and build audio chains the way I have, or what's on my mind and the ideas I have for it. To make the track Biomechanic, I used the following synths. For the beat, I used the Geomox X-Base 09, the Nord Modular G1. For the sequence, it's a Roland Alva Juno 2. The strings is the Roland JX8P. The vocoder is the Nord Modular G1. What's also in there? I think that's everything. That was everything that's in there. And back then I mixed it on a MX8000 analog mixer. Yeah. If I had to go to a lonely island, I must say I would take a computer. a computer with that has installed all plugins and all the stuff that you can get at this moment, because this would has the most possibilities. So I would not take her hardware there. It's a shame, but I would do it like this, because then I have more stuff that I can, more sound and more possibilities to work with. I distort my drums mainly with plugins, with distortion plugins or guitar plugins that I have in my mixing desk. But I also use, I have two cool tubes. I use one cool tube for my mix bus, and I have a second cool tube that it has a decompression mode, and also with the tube you can level the stuff to a amount where you get a very gritty distortion, which sounds very nice. And this one I'm using also to distort my drums. I can only speak how I explored to become a musician. First of all, I had a big motivation to do it. It was a dream. And most of the stuff what I did in the beginning, I copied or I remixed stuff from other artists. That's how I learned much about the music. So I would say it's that way. You analyze stuff from the stuff that you love, and then you get a certain skill on how to handle technique. I mean, today it's more easy with a computer. You have everything you could imagine to make music. So analyzing the stuff, remixing the stuff for yourself, playing the melodies and stuff like this, listening on the sound design, try to imitate it. And from this point, there will come a point where you get on your own ideas. I think it's naturally. So that's how I could give an advice, or would be an advice to how to do it. This question sounds so big, but at the end it's something we do, or everybody of us do it day by day. It's I would call it daydreaming. And if you have a big fantasy and you can go into this fantasy, that's all you have to do. It's nothing special. It's I think the only special thing is that you have to concentrate on it, and you have to let loose the reality itself. It's the sentence, it's possible. It's possible, it's possible, it's possible. It's possible to create something in your mind. It's possible to concentrate on this. It's possible to get it to a certain fantasy that imaginates a realness that you can put it into a creative process. I think there's something that all of us can do. I mean, everybody does it in the moment. You watch a movie that's very intense. It's the imagination of that you're really into it, and it's kind of same process. Only the thing that's different is it's not a story coming out of the TV. It's something that you create by yourself, and you imagine it as a reality. And then you can find the different aspects in there and tell stories about it. I listen to my demos and of course the finals on headphones and judge it also there. Sometimes I use the headphones also here in the studio to listen to the release of a bass drum. because when it's sometimes in a different or in a certain frequency and it's too long, sometimes I don't hear it. So I put the headphones on and then I can clearly hear how long the release is of the bass drum. The headphone is also one option to judge a mix. It's not the main option, but it's a mix between my car speakers, the headphones, quality studio headphones I have, and also the headphones from Apple, the white ones, the shitty ones, and also the speaker from my iPhone, of course my studio speakers. So the mix of all these different speakers I use to judge about the mix. Mostly it's like this: if the mix sounds good on an iPhone, on the Apple shitty headphones, on the laptop, and on my system in the car, it's a good mix, because I expect good mixes to they sound good on nearly everything. Maybe you have a lack of bass, yes, if it's very very deep, but in general the track is still there if it's a good mix. For me, I'm using the stuff that I really like to use and that fits best for my need. For my needs, these discussion about analog and digital. I'm not sure if this is today anymore the deal. I think it depends also if you work with mostly in the computer or with digital stuff. And then everything works fine together. There are some digital instruments, they don't have this, I would call it loudness, but not in the sense of being loud, in a sense of cutting through the mix. And I had some stuff here when I made a production and I used the Voyager, and the beats came from this digital unit. I had to put the volume of the Voyager so much down that I said to myself, something is wrong here. So there's stuff that digitally don't produce that loudness, cannot cut through, is more silent. I don't know what it is exactly, but not all of the digital gear is like this, and some of the analog stuff, it's humming, it has noise floor that's very loud, so you have to deal with different stuff. So I take what I like from analog and digital, and I don't think there is this discussion anymore today. Both things are great in what they can produce in sounds. There's another thing. I mean, I don't use software synthesizers because of the handling. I need stuff where I have hands on. So that's also something I'm really that's really important for me. But I know that the computer stuff with the plugins and all the possibilities in sound design and everything is much greater and bigger than most of the hardware stuff can ever be made with. So like I said, I think there is no discussion about it anymore. It's just the way you want to do things. This question is so big. I think I could talk for hours about it, but maybe I point out some stuff that comes to my mind. I'm always searching for a bass drum that has a punch, and without that I don't have to do too much to get this punch out. So that's why I have some stuff that I'm using frequently. At the moment, my main a bass drum, kick drum, drum computer is the Yomox Alpha Bass. I think to me, it's the best bass drum that's available on the market. And then I'm also using the classics, like I have a 909 and 808. But I also sometimes using samples from a 909 because they already processed in a way that I like, and it cuts through. So, but mostly I'm working with the Alpha Bass at the moment because it's a drum synthesizer, and so I can shape the bass drum in the way I want to hear it, or I can explore new kind of sounds for bass drums. And then also sometimes I'm using the Nord Modular, and I build a patch, a modular patch for drum synth, for a kick drum, where I can do specific stuff with in the digital domain with effects and stuff like this, and can create some drum sounds that's more unusual to a normal drum synthesizer, because most of the drum synthesizers, beside the Alpha Bass, they try to emulate a bass drum that's in a sweet spot and don't takes it goes away too much from the usual sound of a kick drum, which is the 909, the 808. That's why they're so great, because they are in a specific sweet spot, and normally you can't get wrong with those kick drums. That's I think that's why they are so successful, because they are always in the right spot. For snares, I have different drum synthesizers, analog stuff, where I use the different snares from time to time. I'm always using different drum synths for this. But at the moment also I'm using the Akai MPC X to and use my sample library that I have. I use my own snares that I have recorded on stems, and then I sample them or cut them, and then I load it into the machine and use them because they're all already finished or polished and everything. Or I use the multi-layer of the MPC X, and I layer samples together and try to get a snare that has a specific sound design, but then little difference in the sonic sound. So that's what I really like. Also, I use the modular sometimes for snares to have some more synthesized snares, and I mean that's so much stuff. I can create so much snares, but you know, as a musician, you know it yourself. You have like a specific sweet spot of sounds that you like. So at the end, most of the snares I'm producing, they ending. Don't matter what gear I use, some kind in the same spot. If I don't go like in an alien sound or something that's more like experimental. But for the techno and electro stuff, mostly for the electro stuff, I'm going more in always in a like an 808-ish snare sound. For the bass lines, I have no tricks. My bass lines are mostly made with a SH-101 or with the Voyager or with the Wave. What I'm looking for is always that the bass line and the bass drum, the kick drum, that they never goes in too much in the same frequency, so that I have a good punch and a nice bass line. Because once you have a bass drum, you have a note, and if you go too low with the bass line and the bass drum is too high, you get like, yeah, you have to adapt too much to the bass drum, to the kick drum. So I'm always try to have it a little bit out of their ranges from the kick drum and from the bass line, to be free of how I compose the bass line at the end. I don't have these problems, I must say. I don't have much hum problems. At the end, I don't have them because my power, I'm always looking that everything goes away from one power circuit. So the only thing I had was with the wave, and I don't know why. So I bought a DI box and I go like unbalanced with a very small cable like this into the DI box, and then with the XLR or balanced cable to the mixer, and because here there I had hum and hissing problems, and they went away with their DI box. First of all, the vocoder is quite a complex audio chain. First, you have the microphone that goes into a mixer, and then from the mixer you go with the signal into the vocoder, and then it depends which vocoder you have. If you have a vocoder that don't have their own oscillator or synthesizer, then you feed it with the synthesizer or whatever audio signal you want to process with the vocoder. And then the signal that comes out of the vocoder goes back into the mixer, and you equalize it and you compress it. So there are different points in the chain, and all of them are of its own are very important. It's important that you have the right microphone, that you have the right distance on the microphone. It depends on what kind of sound you want to do. Sometimes it's good if you very close to the microphone, and sometimes it better you a bit away from it, because then you have more the pronouncing of the vocoder is better sometimes, and when you closer you the pronouncing is maybe not so good anymore, but you have like a very punchy forward sound in the vocals. Then it's very important the way you pronounce, the way you speak, to get a good sounding vocoder that has a very good the pronouncing is very good. You have to speak or sing in the same melody of the sound you of the melody what you play with the sound. But you can also, if not doing this, get some kind of crazy sounds if you go against the note of the synthesizer. So you need to try it out and listen carefully what happens the way you use your voice. Then it's very important to see if you put a high pass filter on your normal voice and see where you have to put it in the frequencies. As standard, I cut with a high pass filter my voice at 80 hertz. So I think it gets a clearer voice when go in very vocoders that are very low in the note, and then you have to compress the voice a little bit, the best I would say is like between 10 and 20 milliseconds in their attack, and a very short, like 30 milliseconds, a release, and between 2 and 4 dB of the ratio to get the consonants like t, everything that this can cut more true than the other parts of the voice to get the pronouncing better. So this signal then goes into the vocoder, and in the vocoder and the synthesizer sound in the not modular, I have a level for this, better say I built something that I can see both levels, the level of the voice, of my voice signal from the microphone, and the level that comes from the synthesizer. So these levels should be somehow in the same level, because if the level of the oscillator of the synthesizer is too loud, you have like just if the sound of the voice is too high, you don't have this vocoder effect anymore. And if you add some voice, some noise, you also get more of this consonant sounds and the s and sh and everything. But yeah, you have to level this also in a way you want to have the voice. So the level of the voice of the microphone and the oscillator of the synthesizer, I think this is also something that's very important. So then you go with the levels that are in the same into the vocoder, then the vocodized signal that comes out to the mixer, there you compress it with the limiter, and after the limiter you put another compressor with a attack between 10 and 20 milliseconds and a short release about 30 to 50 milliseconds to again get this clearance out of it, like this, like all the consonants, to get him more louder. You also, when you speak into the microphone, you have to listen to it and see if you have to overact the way you speak into the vocoder. That's some fun things that I could tell you. At the end, it depends on what kind of voice you're building with the vocoder. Not in every chain it's working like this, but I would say for 50% of the regular stuff, this should work fine. Learning and discovering as an artist, I think you should never be at the end of learning and discovering, because that's my opinion. That's my motivation to do it. I always want to know what happens next. That's the fuel of my motivation to do music. That's why I'm doing all this. I'm always curious about what happens next. That's also, at this moment, I can say I want to know what happens next. What's the next track I'm doing? What's the next thing I'm finding out? I always want to learn steady. I'm always learning new. I forgot stuff and I learn stuff that I have known before. Also, that's why I have notepads, text files in my studio computer, because I, you know, you discover something, you learn something, and after a month you have forgotten it. So I write down stuff because I know I will forget about it, and maybe in half a year I need to know this again, and then I have it in my notes. So I'm always learning. It should never stop. There are several things the way my studio is organized, I organized my studio as accurate as possible, so that when I'm start writing music, I never have a technical problem. I mean, this is in reality it's different, but theoretically, that's my goal. Because when I'm writing music or when I'm in a creative process, I need everything to work. When I have an idea, for example, I want to do a beat, let's say with a Voyager, and I want to send it through the filter from the Wild of Wave. I have everything on my patch base, and everything is documented. So in this moment, when I have this idea, I want to make sure when I take the patch cable and I route the stuff together that it's working, so that I'm not stuck in like why it's not working, and have to find out the problem, and then the creative moment is gone. I know it. It's gone. That's why everything here is very in order. I'm not that guy that wants everything in order or about perfection or stuff like this. You know, everything should be clean and stuff like this. It's just because I know in this moment I wanna do what I have in my mind. That's why I have this order here. Otherwise, I wouldn't have this order. It's it's something that comes from the motivation to be in control in this moment when I have the idea. So the other thing is, I'm aiming to live a life in a psychological way to have a kind of freedom to come to a very good creativity. I'm always, let's say, working on myself to have freedom, to have not to worry much about thoughts, not having too much thoughts, not doubting stuff that I'm doing creatively, you know, because when you start writing something, the first attempt is mostly not the best. It's, you know, it's something that develops. And if you start doubting on the beginning, you never can come to the good ending. And I'm always optimistic about it, you know. When I'm starting, my ground feeling is like, yeah, it will get to some point where there is something that you're satisfied with. So I'm always trying to motivate myself on this way. It's not working 100% every time, but it's working so often that I feel confident about doing it like this. The third thing is, I try to work fast. And fast in a sense, I try to always be in the goal line before I got bored of the music. And there are different phases for different kind of music. A music that's more complex, like a song or something, needs longer production. So I have strategies to not get bored of it. The first strategy is I work fast on things that's not so important. You know, for example, stuff you know, that could be, that don't have too much precision in the production. That's something I think it's something everybody needs to find out what's not so important for him. I have stuff that's not so important for me, and in a bigger production, I'm rushing over the stuff. I fix it to a point where I think, okay, that's enough, and then I put all my energy into, let's say, recording the voice for the vocoder, cutting the stuff together, adding everything, working on the synthesizer, on the vocoder, and everything, which consumes very much time, and you need a high motivation to go there into the details, because this is something, you know, a voice, or for me, the voice I wanted that it has a very good quality. So there I put the energy into it. Once I'm finished with this, I have it to a point where it's perfect. Then I put the stuff together. I start arranging the stuff, and then I work on other stuff. And I'm always in a production that's more complex, that needs more time to not get bored of it. It's constantly thinking about where I can rush over stuff and where I have to be precisely. And this taking back and forth to not get over this thing, to get bored on the track. Sometimes I'm get bored and then the track will go to the trash. I mean, it's not every time possible, but that's the way I work for stuff that's more difficult. And the stuff like the club stuff. That stuff I work more on a bass, on a jam the stuff in, and sometimes I'll record a jam and leave it like this. So there you must work more faster, because it's two sequences, and if you listen too much to the stuff, you're losing the feeling of this open and like playing element, because you heard it too much, and then stuff that's not so that looks like it's too easy, or it's not so fascinating, you lose the feeling to see this kind of stuff. And that's important for the club music, because club music is more like repetitive, and it has the small stuff, and you need to know tense and have the feeling for this. So on the club stuff that's more basic, I try to really to rush over everything and try to do it as fast as possible. I'm putting more. I'm counting more on the process afterwards when I do the mastering, which I do these days. I do it by myself. I know if there's something I can't fix it in the right way, I try to fix it to a certain way, and then I leave it, because I know afterwards when I work on the mastering, I can compress it and it will be fine. Or maybe I don't hear it anymore. I forgot about it, that it's like this. So, yeah, that's the way I do it. Yeah, compression. That's a thing. To me, I think I have understood compression, but I know I didn't. And everything I tell you now is what I know at the moment about compression, because the different compressors and the different techniques and everything, there's nothing like something I think that's overall right for compression. So in my mixing desk, I usually use the channel compressor, and I'm compressing mostly with 2:1, the ratio 2:1. And what I do, I know the BPM of the track, and I'm calculating the release and the attack times in 16th notes for most of the stuff for the compression. And I have the feeling when I'm listening to it that this is working fine. So that's how I'm working. If I have a synthesizer like the Wave, which has in the dynamics when you play a sequence with it, it goes in the dynamics like between 6 dBs up and down, then sometimes I take the ratio 4:1 to get it more together. And for vocal stuff or for strings, I'm using more like a limiter from Waves, the L1, because I get a more steady a signal without to fix the attack and release time. And sometimes I'm also using the L1, the Waves L1 limiter for all kind of stuff to get it together, because it's more like, yeah, getting the stuff together in a certain way. What I feel, I can't do it with a channel compressor. My mix bus, I don't have a compressor in there. I've used to have this like years ago, but to me, I found out having a compressor in the mix bus. I have the feeling I'm mixing against the compressor and mixing against other channels. If I mix a bass line, or I mix the hi-hats, I mix against the bass drum or the snare drum. So that's why I record all my pre-masters without a compressor in the mix bus. I know some people, they have it in there, they can mix like this, but I get better results without it. It's something you have to get used to it, because you don't have this like this compressed slamming pumping sound, but for me it works better to do it like this.